Thank you, Chair. Thank you for that very, you know, that good introduction regarding the historical relations between the eastern part of India and Sri Lanka. What I'm going to do today is that I'm going to focus my paper on national interest and security. Because I think when one speaks of national interest, basically mostly it is understood in terms of territorial sovereignty, but security is much more broader framework. Like the national interest, it has both economic, social, political, and definitely the territorial, the sovereignty aspect. So how does these two component of any particular state interacts with the globalizing world? Because unlike in the past, it needs to be recognized that the countries are much more globalized. Not only globalized because of the information technology, or for that matter, I think it is more globalized because of the United Nations system. We have various organizations, multilateral organizations like the WTO, the climate governance, which actually is trying to fix an emission limit, which many of the developing countries also have certain problem with that particular fixation. One also has international institutes like the World Bank and the IMF and others, which actually impinge on the national interest and security of any particular countries. So therefore, you know, this gives, you know, this takes us to the next level of the question, that how does a country protect its national interest and security given the kind of constraint the global governing bodies have? Because as all of us we know, these are not very democratic bodies, still dominated by the developing countries. So therefore, the voice of the developing, especially the developed countries, which has been dominating some of the economic, you know, multilateral organization, actually has been extremely dominant. So therefore, you know, I am going to link it that how, you know, the countries of the region, especially the developing countries, the emerging power, can actually play a role in democratization of these international institutions, which actually provide them a kind of space not only to voice their views on important aspect of, you know, aspect of economics, which affects most of the countries of the nation, of the world. So therefore, I'm going to make the linkage. I think one of the, you know, what I have done is that I have divided this study into three parts, basically dealing with three questions related to this particular subject which I am speaking on. The first part is that can national interest be state-centric? I think we listened to a lot of presentation that perhaps it cannot be state-centric because it has to be comprehensive, and there are many departments and institutes of a particular state, or you know, the you know, various ministries, which plays very important role not only in shaping what is national interest, but also at the same time, it is going, you know, it has a much more broader dimension of human security. And in the same section, one can actually look at, is security synonymous with territorial integrity? And can national interest be divorced from, you know, the immediate regional context or the geopolitics of, you know, a particular country's geographical location? The second aspect which I have dealt in my paper is that can national interest be divorced from the process of globalization? Like I said, you know, one has seen in the recent past how the world economic crisis affected many of the countries. Some countries survived because of their own indigenous institutional structure, which were very strong and had taken the indigenous dimension of economic development, and some countries were very badly affected because of the process of global recession. Nevertheless, I think almost all the countries were affected by the process of globalization. Now, the third section, what I'm going to do is that, how does the national interest and security interact with global governance regime? Given the limited time, I would rather take some of the questions during my question answer session. So what I've done is, basically I'm speaking on basic you know, arguments on each of the three issues which I have already, I've already spoken and, you know, have made different three sections. I think why, you know, it has been state-centric for some of the states, not all of the states, because if one looks at South Asia especially, I think most of the countries in the region are developing countries, and each one of them has faced the problem of nation building, you know, because these are newly emergent country, and most of us, we have this history of 60 to 65 years, minus the two states in South Asia, that is Nepal and Bhutan. But I think the fragile institutional structure of most of the states actually has not helped the matter, because democracy is definitely much more new, relatively new, compared to many of the countries of the world. So therefore, I would like to argue that the fragile, the institutions are still fragile. So that doesn't give much confidence to the people at some time, and also at the same time doesn't take into account the structure within the state. I think given the fact that these states are relatively new states, the security of these states has been state-centric. Diversity is less celebrated in political terms in most of the countries, and the states are still in the process of democratization. Some of the states in South Asia also transited to democracy in 2008. If you look at the examples of Bangladesh, which had, you know, restored democracy in 2008 after 2 years of military-backed caretaker government. Same is the context of what I've seen in Bhutan and also in Pakistan. So while the sovereignty is extremely important and the process of globalization has reduced its meaning in absolute terms, national interest has got better served with global governance regime, whether it is the economic regime, like I said, you know, the WTO or the climate change regime or UN and its various organs. I think one needs to deal with security and also the, you know, the question of security and peacekeeping. I think all this reflects that global regimes are geared towards stability of the state. So one cannot say that the global regimes actually is leading to a kind of destabilization, but I think it leads to a lot of stability as the state interact much more globally through the multilateral institution in the absence of a system where you have multiple powers. It is much more now the single dominant power, that is the United States, which is leading the global, the international regime. I think, with the lack of multipolarity, I think to a very large extent, for the time being, these global institutional regimes are going to play extremely important role. I think all the states of South Asia, like I said, have already transited to democracy. Thus, the human security aspect also have become much more important than before. The Sri Lanka's post-war efforts are also geared towards responding the humanitarian aspect of the conflict. Most of us, we have already spoken about this. And the democratization also has made inevitably some of the people as the stakeholder. So therefore, national interest security cannot be divorced from the regional context. I think another thing one needs to be, keep in mind while analyzing the, the South Asian states and its interaction with various international regimes and also the global international order, one needs to also remember the porous or vulnerable borders, ethnic groups, and which crisscrosses the national boundary. So there are certain issues which actually is the internal matter of a particular state, inevitably makes it a bilateral matter because of this kind of ethnic affinity, linguistic affinity, which, and also the religious affinity, which most of the countries in the region share with each other, because that actually has resonance in the domestic politics of the another state. Now, can national interest and security be achieved without global cooperation? I think both the economic component of the security of the state can be better realized. Both economic and security component of the state can be better realized through global cooperation. I think if you look at the security, I think before 2001. Basically, most of the states, when they were facing this problem of terrorism in South Asia, and there was no global effort actually to deal with the challenges of terrorism in this part of the world, after 2001, one saw the significant change of attitude of various government, including the United Nations, as far as terrorism in this part of the region is concerned. Because earlier, most of the time, many of the proponent were generally speaking of freedom struggle, but after 2001, this outlook towards terrorism completely changed, and I think it was possible because of global cooperation and cooperation between various regions. I think Sri Lanka also is also a beneficiary of that particular cooperation at that point of time, where the terrorist network which was existing in various countries of the world was decimated and, to a large extent contributed the final victory against terrorism in Sri Lanka. So therefore, I think one needs to look at how to exploit this organization, this global component in protecting one's national interest and security. Let me come to the third part of my presentation. I think we keep on speaking of realism, and just I'll take 1 minute. When one speaks of realism, one speaks basically of anarchical world, of relative gains, and I think if we look at the institutional perspective, I think that actually gives a lot of space to protect one's national security and interest. So therefore, I think it is in the interest of India and Sri Lanka to democratize the international governance structure and get involved in multilateral forum, because I don't see there is any other alternative rather than getting the countries involved in this multilateral forum to protect one's own interest. I think emerging countries should strive for establishing global governance norms that will provide them greater say in international affairs. I think this is going to be extremely important as far as India and Sri Lanka is concerned, and probably the question here is to revitalize some of the regional organizations like SAARC. There was a presentation on IOR, ARC. I think this needs to be vitalized. Thank you so much. I look forward for questions. Thank you.